All right, we're going to start our meeting. Debbie was unable to make it tonight. John has some family over, so that's a little bit more important. We do have a guest, if you'd like, two guests. So if they would come up here and speak, tell us about themselves, that would be great. Guest number one in the back there. You gotta come up here though.
We don't have cordless mic yet.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we don't have a cordless mic, so.
What did you like to know?
Your name, where are you from?
Okay. Name is Ari Markowitz. I live in Monroe, Greenbrier, Twillingham. I use a mirrorless camera, the Sony A6300, because I like to walk a lot and travel and walk a lot, and it's less heavy than the Nikon I used to have. I'm not getting any younger, so the less heavy the product, the better for me. I was Rich Port invited me over, so I'm here to learn as much as I can, and that's it.
Excellent. Thank you. And our other guest is over here.
Can you tell us about yourself? Yeah, my name's Ernie in Cranbury, and this is my second meeting here to learn some stuff about digital editing.
Thank you. Melinda, you want to come up? I don't think, actually, we do have a couple guests online. Let me just go through. I will make it easy. If you guys could unmute yourself and tell you about yourselves, you could do that now, please. So, like, Al, maybe. There's a Barb, Bernard, Caroline. There's a bunch of names in here. Nancy, tell us about yourself.
I'm in Long Island, New York, Northport, and I'm a Nikon shooter, and I am in Huntington Camera Club. I used to belong to the Rockland County Camera Club. So I got a notice, I think, from that club that this was happening and an invite. So I'm happy to be here.
Excellent. Thank you. There's Caroline, Deborah's in here, Frank, any of you guys? Bunch of names I don't recognize. If you unmute yourself, you can tell us about yourself. I'll ask you to unmute now.
Can you hear me now?
We can hear you now, Al.
Okay. Before it said the host would not allow me to unmute, but thank you. Okay. I'm a member of the Westchester Photo Society, and basically, anytime I hear a basic review of stuff, I'm in. So I'm looking forward to tonight's program.
Excellent. Thank you. Barbara?
Hi. I was just able to unmute, so I wasn't before. So if anybody's trying, you should be able to do it now. I'm a member of the Morristown Camera Club, or I forget the official name. Haven't been doing much. I'm just starting in digital. So I hope this will help me get some confidence in taking some pictures and printing, you know, and working with them. And you'll excuse my cat walking across the desk. Thank you. And thank you for this.
No problem. Thank you. Who else? Who's next?
My name is Lou, and I am also at the Morris Photo Color Camera Club. About 40 years ago, I was in Livingston Camera Club, and I switched over to digital about 10 years ago, and I shoot with Nikon, and I was not doing much with any kind of editing, and I was back and forth between people advising me to go with Photoshop, people advising me to go with Lightroom, and ultimately one person convinced me to go with Lightroom. So I've been doing some stuff in Lightroom, but there's, now I say I want to live long enough to learn everything there is to know about Lightroom. That'll be a long time. It does so many things, and I'm sure it does even more than I even know about. And so I'm looking to learn more.
Excellent. Thank you.
I have a question for Barb. By any chance, are you related to Kim Cooper Smith Warner?
Not that I know of. It's Cooper Smith with a K, which is unusual.
Yeah, I think she was with a K also.
Do you know where she was?
Midtown Manhattan was an attorney.
Not that I know of, but maybe through my ex, who knows?
Her father was Ken Cooper Smith.
Okay. It would have to be my ex, so I don't know. He wasn't too close to most of his family.
Caroline?
Hi, I'm Caroline. I'm from the Stamford, Connecticut Camera Club, and I'm happy to be here to learn some of the new tricks that Lightroom Classic has added to their software. So I'm looking forward to today, and thank you for inviting us.
Thank you. Anybody left?
Yeah. I'm a member of the Monmouth Camera Club. I got the invitation through them, and I'm interested in learning the new, what's going on with the Lightroom now.
Excellent. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Linda Whalen. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
I'm a new member of the Huntington Camera Club. And I have been working with Lightroom for quite a while, but I have to say, there's still some things that I get snagged on or that I don't understand how to use. So I hope I get more knowledge tonight.
Excellent. All right, I think that's all the guests. So Melinda, you had some information for us?
Okay. So for round three of the PSA color competition, I did send it out in an email, but I wanted to recognize Debbie Aniano for her Icelandic beauties. She got a merit award. Congratulations, Debbie. And Susan Lytle for her incoming American oyster catcher. She got an HM. So congratulations to Susan. Unfortunately, there were no winners in the monochrome competition. The next PSA competition will be in September, and I will send out an email with the date. Thank you.
Thank you. There's no NJFCC stuff till the fall, so I don't even see Terry in the meeting. I know he did just send out a email about our winter competition coming up and how to photograph that. So if you did not see that, email Terry and he can re-forward it to you. And we didn't get much winter, but hopefully some people got some photos. And I think that's all we have. We just have Valerie to announce our speaker tonight.
Okay, so welcome everyone. Everyone's new and all our club members. Today we have our very own Rose. Yay! So Rose is one of our members, and she is or has been a photographer for almost 38 years, and she started off in film. But I mean, she's an expert. I started in film too, so. her first camera was, I need my glasses, I don't have them. A Minolta X370 with a 55 millimeter prime lens. She spent several years working in the lab environment, color correcting film, negatives, printing in a dark room, before she finally embraced digital editing. And now she's been working in Lightroom since 2010. And she appreciates that they continually strive to improve the program to meet the needs of today's photographers. And she's going to show us some of her tips and tricks. If she has any hand, do you have handouts? Okay. She have handouts that she's also going to share with us afterwards. Thank you, Rose.
Can you hear me now? All right, so tonight it really is a basic Lightroom editing, you know, showing you how to import stuff, export stuff, and use the basic workflow and functions to get your photos where you need, where you want them. So some of the things that we do in Lightroom, everybody has to find a workflow that's going to work for them. My workflow might not work for you, but there are certain things that you really want to do first in your workflow before you go into your editing. Some of the things we're going to talk about tonight when we're importing is the importance of keywords and organization when you're importing. Then we're going to go over editing your images, some of the toolboxes, exporting, and we're going to go over my workflow and how I do things, and I'm going to explain why I do it that way. So pretty much when you're importing your photos, you went to your favorite place, you have your images. You know, I know for myself, when I go out and shoot, I can take anywhere between 50 photos to a couple thousand, depending on where I'm at. 50 photos is real easy to go back and find things, but a couple thousand, if they're not keyworded properly, you're not going to find what you're looking for. The more keywords you use, better off you're going to be. But along with the keywording, that's part of an organization, but everybody organizes differently. And I'll be the first one to say, my organization's out the window because I've tried so many different things. One person will tell you, don't go by date. Don't organize by date. Another person will tell you to organize by subject or place. Honestly, what I find, I remember dates better. So I remember around when I took it. So at that point, guess what? I'm redoing everything in my catalog and I have a lot of pictures to reorganize. But I know and have an idea of where I have to look when I'm looking for something. You're going to find your process. The processes are going to be just, they're going to be so varied that nobody can tell you what's right and wrong for you and how to do it. I'm going to give you ideas, like I said, organization, dates, places, what you photographed, keywords, be as precise as possible. If you're looking for, if you shot purple flowers, then put in purple flowers as some of your keywords. So we're going to look at some of these steps as we go along. So your primary thing when you're importing, you're going to, what? Oh, all right, give me a second. All right, so how do I share my screen, Matthew? All right, there we go. I got it. It says you disabled it. Can't share something. So if I want to do a split screen, I can't do a split screen.
No, it's one or the other. You can just do the whole screen.
Well, that's what I'll do, but I wanted to turn around and go down my list, which I can't see. All right, it's not a big deal. I'll have to flip back and forth. So primarily when we're importing, you're obviously going to open Lightroom. You're going to go to File, Import Photo and Video, and we're going to go through this in Lightroom shortly. You're going to Before you even import, you are going to go through your images. You are going to get rid of anything that is blurry, stuff that you don't want to edit, stuff that you know is trash. Don't even import it. Don't waste the space. Don't waste your time of having to call it at a later time. Once you're done with that, we're going to go into keywording. So primarily, once you're in Lightroom, you're going to go to library, import, okay. You're going to go to where do your files that you're importing reside. So here are my files that I'm going to import for tonight. And I missed the key step. Anybody know, see what I just missed when I went to go import and I told you should do on import? I didn't keyword. Okay, so if I were to import right over here, so right here, you would put your keywords in. So I grabbed a bunch of different photos that I've had. So I would put in rodeo, put a comma in between. If you want something that's going to be a phrase, then you can put it in as a phrase. So fox on beach, it's going to carry it as a phrase. All right. I'm just going to click done. My photos are now in. Over here, I just showed where your things, if you went to file, you pretty much can do the same thing. You would go to import photos or video. Same process that we just went through. So here's some information on keywording. Use keywords that will help you find your photos at a later date. Perhaps you don't remember when you took the photos, but you know you need pink flowers. Search for pink flowers, and all of your photos that have the keyword pink flowers will magically appear before your eyes. 2, decide on how you want your photos organized before you even start to import. If you want to organize by subject, think about how you want to handle shooting several subjects in one day. Perhaps you took photos of birds. Along the way, you found some really cool patterns and decided to photograph them. If you are organizing by subject, you can't put your patterns in your bird folder. Now, let's say you photographed eagles and a couple types of hawks. Are you going to organize your birds, you're organized by birds of prey and then break it down by types? Eagle, golden is one folder and bald is another. Your hawk folder might have the following folders under the subheadings, redtail, goshawk, etc. Think about how you want to do this before you go in. Not everybody, you may have gone out to go shoot boats that day, but it doesn't mean that every single photo is a boat. But do you want pictures of waves in with your boat photos? As you can see, there's a lot of work and thinking ahead if you choose to organize by subject. This is one of the reasons I choose to organize by date and keyword, keyword, keyword. The keywords are going to save you if somehow you fail on where your organization is. Yes.
When you import them, is the whole file?
Yeah, if you keyword when you're importing, all those keywords are going to show up on.
Nobody can see this.
What was that?
Nobody can see that. Go back to share. Hit stop share. Right,
okay.
Hit stop share because you got to share screen instead.
I wish it.
Yeah, you're sharing just the application.
Okay.
Hit share again. Then hit screen.
Okay, so we have to go back and forth?
And then hit share. And now then it should show whatever's on your screen.
Okay, so now they should be able to, all right. So as we were saying, if you turn around and you shot boats, but then you shot waves, and you're importing that whole part at one time, and you wanted to organize, say, under beach stuff or shore stuff, and you want to put the boats in one folder and the waves in another, you actually had to go through and unclick. If you're going to turn around and do your boats first, you have to unclick all those wave shots. Then you can keyword. But if you yeah, you can't key when you're importing, you cannot keyword on specific pictures unless you turn off the importing on the images you don't want to have those keywords. It's, you know what? It's, I like the keywording in the fact when you're importing because it's done. So when I'm importing, if I shot different things, which I always do throughout the day, I really do turn around unless I've shot thousands and thousands of images. Like when you go to Conowingo, you're not walking away with five pictures. Then I will go through and say, okay, I peruse through most of my pictures are boats. I'm going to turn off everything that's not boats. I'll import my boats with all my keywords. Then I will go back in and do the ones of waves.
The question then becomes, going to import five, you're putting all the different keywords and everything that you're seeing in that whole thing, and then later you can turn those keywords on and off.
Yes, you can go in and turn them off later. That you can do, but the whole thing is, if you do it a week later, you're not going to remember every image you shot to turn it off. I mean, there's several ways of doing it. To me, this is the most simple way of doing it to at least get those basic keywords in. Because like I said, if you change how you organize things down the road and say, I don't like doing it by dates. I want to do it by this. I want to do it by subjects. If those keywords are in there, you can say, hey, I want to turn around and put pink flowers under flowers. Now you can pull your pink flowers. But if you didn't keyword when it went in, where are you at? You're kind of like stuck with things all over the place. For me, I'd rather have that small work done because I don't want to take time at a later date. If I want to take the time, I want to take the time working on my editing, maybe doing something different with the image. But like I said, I don't want to have to take the time in reorganizing or re-keywording. And trust me, I'm the biggest offender of forgetting to do things. You just saw that. All right, let's get this in. Next thing you know, I have 1,000 images that are in there. But the whole thing is, it's the second step, and I'll show you how you can do it. To turn around and keyword and blanket it if I remember how to do it, because I don't do it that often to be able to do it, but I think I remember. So we'll go over that. So primarily now you have all your images in, you can see where I've highlighted where you're going to put your keywords. Your organization is going to be down here. You're going to name your folders. You're going to figure out what drive you're putting it on. As to whether some people like turning around and building smart previews because it helps Lightroom to load quicker, you have an option. You can either wait for it to load and import and build the smart previews, or you can wait for it to load when you're editing. 6 1 half dozen in the other. Either way, you're waiting on something. If you're only bringing in some, you know, a small amount of photos, it's not a big deal. But like I said, there's times I go out, I'm shooting thousands and building smart previews. I don't want to wait. I want to get in there and start doing things. So next is my workflow. And I'm kind of going through this pretty quick because I actually want to take you through a photo or two of the actual editing process. So my workflow is I import, I keyword, I organize, and then I take it, I start my editing. And I will peruse photos sometimes as a first thing, and I will look at them and I will mark them 1 through 5 as to how I want to edit them. Do I want to take time to edit it now? Do I want to do it at a later date? When I'm all done going through, I'm going to take the ones that I want to sit down and work on right now and say, okay, I want to put time into these. The other ones, no big deal. The first thing I do is I'm going to do the simple things. I'm going to make sure that my horizon is level. I'm going to make sure my photo is cropped if I want it cropped. I'm going to make sure that my buildings are not off kilter. So I'm going to do my alignment, my transformations, anything that I need to do to visually correct the image that does not have anything to do with exposure or anything else. I'm going to do any lens corrections. Sometimes I try to remember to do lens corrections at the very beginning, because you will find that sometimes when you do the other things and you do the lens correction, it winds up reverting the image kind of back to where it was. But those, like I said, those are the things I want done first. I don't want to do anything else to that image until I have that corrected and fixed. The next thing I'm going to do, and some people might disagree, is when you go into Lightroom, and we're just going to bring up a picture here. Is go into the develop module. There's this little button here called auto. I love it. That doesn't mean that you're going to click that and your picture's going to be ready. It is not going to be ready. It is going to give you a place to start. So we're going to go through the first things that I would do with this image that we were just discussing. And lens correction. Always click remove chromatic aberration and enable the profile. So if you notice, they really didn't do a whole heck of a lot. Some images you'll see, not a drastic, but you will see a big change when you click that. All right. So my next thing that I want to do is my horizon line is not correct. But if you're looking at the horizon line right now, look at the telephone poles. When I fix my horizon line, my telephone poles kind of look wonky. But if I look at my bar over here, when I fix my horizon, I'm straight. So I'm happy with that. But one of the things I want to do is, if you look at the right-hand side of the photo, when I just did that, it cut into that second horse. So now I'm going to move it over as much as I can. At this point, you're not really doing much more. There's nothing to transform. You've corrected your horizon line, and now you can actually work on your editing. So you would just close that out, You're good there right now. So now we're going to work on our editing and what we're looking for. So as I said, I start off with auto. So now I clicked auto. There wasn't really a whole big change. And so there we go. That's side by side. Left picture is the before, the right is the after. It really didn't do much of anything. So when it comes to this, most people can say, okay, that's a fairly decent edit. I like the way it looks. So I'm gonna go from here. As I've said, I've edited for a really, really long time. And while it did make a slight improvement, I don't like this. For me, I want to bring my exposure down a little bit. Maybe bring my shadows up a little bit because I want to see this kid's face. All right. You can see it. But I want it up a little bit more. I also want to bring a little bit more contrast in. I tend to like contrasty images. For this, I want that contrast in there. I want to bring my blacks down. Every single thing you do, one thing affects the other. Okay? So when you're playing with your blacks, it affects your shadows. Playing white, it affects your highlights. All right? And then if you... There. All right. So I'm going to do some really wonky things with this because I want you to see this. So right now I'm going to really bring the blacks down. And if you notice, everything that you've lost detail in has just turned blue because I just turned on the little black button that's going to tell me I lost detail in my blacks. Some people will tell you, you keep coming up, you bring your black up until the blue goes away. I want mine a little darker. It's okay that I've lost some detail in the shirts. There really wasn't much detail in there to begin with. You can do the same thing with whites. So now if I bring my whites up, everything that's white is blown out. The highlights are not gonna change much. Your whites you want to bring down, again, depending. This image, while I like contrast, doesn't lend itself to have a nice contrasty feel to it. Those would be your absolutely basic editing for something like this. But there's other things you can do to bring stuff out. Your texture, if you increase texture, which increases sharpness a bit, then you would decrease your clarity a little bit. While they work hand in hand, if you bring both of them up or both of them down, you're either going to have a super soft image or a image that I'm going to say appears noisy because it's over sharpened. So they work in balance together. Dehaze is nice. If you bring it up, though, you actually see some increase in saturation. If you bring it down, kind of gives you an ethereal look, like it's fogged out. I do like to use it, and I do play with it, because sometimes I really don't want to increase saturation or vibrancy, but just pulling out some of that or adding some of the haze, I think kind of lends itself to helping increase the saturation. Again, some of these buttons you really have to sit and you have to play with and see what you like. The biggest thing is getting your colors correct and your contrast, your exposure, all those things are going to bring out different things in the photo that's going to draw your eye. What is the most important thing? So the one thing I was always taught when I learned how to edit was, if there's a person in your photo, you edit for the person, which means their skin tone has to be correct. If I were to do that in this image, I'm going to lose a lot of other stuff that's in here. Because to me, while there's people, the focus is the horses and the action of what these people are doing. So it's not a portrait. I'm not correcting for a portrait. I'm correcting for an action image. So you also have to look, while that's good advice, always make sure you correct for a person. It doesn't always work. Just because there's people there doesn't mean that you have to correct for them. That doesn't mean make them blue or purple or red or pink. All right, there has to be balance. One of the things that some people will tell you is vignetting, however you want to say the word, not to do it. Well, when it's done properly, it draws your eye into where it's supposed to be. Okay. Does every image need it? Absolutely not. Does this image need it? Absolutely. Because my edges are bright. I could turn around and crop, but I don't want to crop because, you know, the kid on the left-hand side lends to the image. The kid on the right-hand side lends to the image. I have no room to crop on the right. I have no room to crop on the left. But I still want to draw your eye to the kid that's on that fucking bronc. He's the important image. He's the important subject that's there. So I'm going to break it in just a little bit. Just that tiny bit. It's not standing out, but it darkened it enough that now that white shirt that kid's wearing is bringing you in. And there's some other pictures that I'm going to go through we will go over other things. But like I said, this here was just a very general image. In here, I might also turn around and bump up the vibrance a little because I want to bring his chaps out. I want to bring the red of the horse out a little bit more. Will I do that to every image? No. But like I said, there's certain things that I want seen in this image that I want to stand out. And is this one of my best images of rodeo? Absolutely not. But it was one that gave me kind of something where I can point things out and show different things. Does anybody have any questions? Are there any questions in chat, Matt? All right, so we're going to do another image. This will give you a good idea of having to fix things before you go any further. I know everybody tells you get it right in camera. It's not always possible because sometimes the action's happening too fast, and when you're shooting something like rodeo, you're not only trying to get the shots, but you're trying to make sure there's nothing that's going to come out after you. I've been down there when they're doing buckouts. I've been right on the other side of the fence, and trust me, it's much easier to sit in the seats than down there, because when these things go, they go. So I know when I go and shoot rodeo, I'm going to be fixing and transforming a lot of things. Again, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to do a lens correction first. Get that done. It doesn't do much, but it does what it needs to do. And then we're going to go up. Go ahead. Is this in Zoom? Give me a second. I'm sorry, because I'm like congested, so hearing everything is not. Okay, import presets. All right. Al, we'll talk about that when I use them. And I'll use them on a photo in a minute. Is that what you were telling me, Melinda? Yeah. Okay.
I wanted to know about the lens. So we did lens correction.
Okay, so when we do lens correction. All right. Okay, so one is chromatic aberration. So that's pretty much, like, sometimes you'll see fringing. You'll see it on cheaper lenses. It gives a purplish magenta, sometimes green fringing around the outside edges. Sometimes it'll represent itself as noise. If you're using better lenses, the better lenses tend to not have it. Okay, the button. So here's the button right here. Remove chromatic aberration. So right under your lens correction is that and the enable profile for your lens. So Lightroom is going to know what lens you shot with. If it doesn't know, it's not going to show anything under your lens profile. Okay. You are not going to really see the change with the removed chromatic aberration, because most times if it's there, it's so mild that your eye is not picking it up. And you would have to really blow up the photo. And I'm talking beyond pixel Pete, especially with the newer lenses out there, to see it. I click it out of force of habit. Okay. I mean, a lot of my lenses, I've never seen it. But like I said, it's always good to have it, and it's always good to use it. It's not going to hurt anything by having it clicked under the lens correction. There are things, and it's more advanced, like something like the lens correction, you can set up a preset so that when you're importing, it automatically does that. We're not even getting into that right now, because that's a whole other thing. Does that answer your question, Val? So again, here, I have an image. It's obviously off kilter. I'm going to go in and I'm going to straighten it. You have to figure out what's the most important thing for you. All right. So right now my top is straightened, but if you look at these over here, they're not. So do I want my roof line straight? Do I want my fence line straight? Or do I want my pole straight? Sometimes you got to kind of pick the middle. I think I want the fence straight, because to me, that's the next thing that you really see behind him. I'm also going to crop down, because if I leave it the way it is right now, I'm getting part of that roof in. I don't want that roof in. So I might come down here. I'm going to realign myself. I'm going to follow the rules right now. I centered my image. I'm not big on centered images like that. It is the main portion of the image. I'm going to go with it. But now that I just did this, I just noticed I cut their heads off. So I'm going to go in again, because I don't want headless people, even though they're not the subject. I'm going to bring it down. I'm going to bring them back in. To me, they're good right now. Again, I'm going to auto. Doesn't do a whole lot. I'm going to bring my contrast up. I'm going to bring my exposure down. It was a rainy day that day. And I don't want things bright. It wasn't a bright day. I'm going to bring my shadows up just a tiny bit to bring his face out. All right. My blacks, I'm going to leave. I'm satisfied with my whites. Texture and clarity. I don't really want to go wonky with it. I'm going to dehaze it a little bit. It helps me saturate colors. This here, I want a bit more saturation in. So I'm going to up my saturation. Bring my vibrancy down a little bit. Well, to me, that doesn't work. So now I'm going to bring my saturation down, but I want it more vibrant. So this time I'm breaking the rules, because you really shouldn't have both of them in the positive, because they should kind of offset each other. But I'm happy with where I'm at. So now we're going to play presets for a second, because somebody asked about them. And the first, to me, this is a hard rule. A preset is just a starting point. That's all it is. That's not, it should not be, you should not press on a preset and go, okay, it's all done now, because it's not. It is a starting point. So one thing that's nice is when you're going through presets, you don't even have to click on them. You just have to roll over them and it'll change the image so you can see, oh, well, I like that or I don't like that. You know, this is kind of cool. You can figure out where you want to play first. So I'm a black and white person. And they didn't load a lot of presets on this computer because it's not my main editing computer. So I like that one, but I really kind of like this one. Yeah, it darkened the image, but I'm gonna start this as a starting point. So I clicked it. Here is a new thing in Lightroom, and I love it. It's a slider. It used to be that you put a preset on and you had no way of controlling how much it affected the image. Now you do. So it starts off that preset is on 100%. Well, I can increase it to 200%, or I can decrease it. So now when you're working with a black and white one, while it decreases it, it's still keeping the image black and white. So, and it'll do the same thing with color, but you would think that if you're working with a monochrome slider, that when you decreased the effect, that you'd start seeing some color come through. You don't. So here I am. This is a starting point. I kind of like it right about there. But now I can come over here again and I can hit auto again and say, oh, okay, well, you know, I don't like it. So I can control Z and it's going to undo that auto setting that I just did. I can come through and say, you know what? I like where that's at, but let me dehaze it. I want it to be kind of like it was misty out that day. And there's so many different things that you can do. It's a matter of playing. But if you noticed how that dehaze, when I brought it all the way up there, it made it really hazy. Well, you can kind of get the same effect with clarity and dropping it. And you kind of get that same effect with texture. So you really have to turn around and learn how to play with the sliders, not be afraid of using the sliders. Lightroom does not change the image. So it's, I think, what they call a lossless effect. So you can go back and go right to the image when we started out by hitting reset. And there we go. Everything you just did is gone. You have a history down at the bottom that will show you everything you did to that image. So if I click on any point in that history, it'll bring me right back to where that was. So if you did something that you liked and then you played with a bunch of other things, you know, you can say, okay, well, that's where I like it. And you can right click. So I want to, here's what I liked. The one I right click and I'm going to clear history above this step that I have clicked. So there you go. I just cleared everything else that I did after I hit my preset. I didn't like it. I liked when I hit my preset and I had my preset. So that's, you know, where I'm going to stay. Is everybody following me? I don't want to bore anybody to death with this. Rose. Yes. Yeah, it deleted. When I hit reset, well, which reset? When I hit reset to the right and started right from the beginning. So when I hit reset to the right, it clears every single thing I did. It brings me right back to the original imported image. If I go to history, okay, which is on the left-hand side, I find the point that I like the image, which here was the... When I originally hit the preset, I didn't like anything I did after that. So now I can right click on that portion and say, okay, you know, I want everything above there gone. And then I could start from there. So you're saving having to turn around and you know, either Command Z or Control Z to get rid of all those steps or undo all those steps. If you completely didn't like what you did to the image and you want to start over, just hit reset on the right hand side underneath your editing and start all over. If there was something that you remembered that you liked throughout editing, then I would sit there and play with the history and be like, okay, all right, that's the one that I liked and I don't want anything beyond that right now, and I want to start over from this point. Instead of having to re-edit the image, you know you got it to that point that you liked it, but you wanted to do more tweaking, but you didn't like the tweaking that you had done. So I think at this point we're going to take a break, and then I can kind of find out what other questions people have and what else they'd like me to show them in here.
Excellent. So we'll take a 5-minute break here for coffee and bathroom break, and we'll be right back.
Something in there that we see. I'm not even sure. Photo I have in my background was a topaz photo. But either way, when you're working with sharpening within Lightroom, there's a couple things that can help you out, and they're really kind of cool. So we're going to do just a really quick auto on here. And I'm not talking, just I just want to go through this really quick to turn around and do a few things. So here would be something very basic. So some of the things before we actually go into detail and stuff like that is your healing tools. We have new healing tools now, or there's a new one. It's a content aware healing tool, and it's really fun to play with because it really works. So before I show you how to use that real quick, let me just put that. So this right here, I want this gone. I don't like that little stick there. So I'm gonna come in. I have my content aware. You really do want this as small as you can get it. Right now we're gonna do a quick and dirty. So we're gonna highlight that. I'm gonna let it do its thing. I'm going to tell it it's done. I'm going to tell it it's done. There we go. It's all gone. It's a heck of a lot better than turning around and going through their clone or their little healing brush. But each one of those has its purpose. It really does. The content aware is great and I love it. But if you have something that's really dark in the image, I tend to find one of the other tools sometimes work better. You have to play to see what's going to work. They're all going to work, but one is going to work better for what you're doing. Like I said, I think the content aware does a really good job, but if I had major stuff to do in a photo, dust, it's great for that. But if I have a plane, sometimes those planes come out really dark and I'm just not real happy if using the content aware. Sometimes you're going to have clouds that are really difficult to turn around and fix flying birds through. I find the content aware doesn't do as well on those. So I might go into the healing brush or the clone tool, because then you really have to kind of zero in on what you want it replaced with. Because sometimes it's as simple as, you know, what it picks for the content aware is a couple of shades off. And even though you're doing it on a zoomed photo, you can tell yourself, oh, well, when I put it back down to, you know, just the regular size, I'm not going to notice it. You know what? I know where it's at. And I'm going to look. And that's going to keep drawing my attention. And I want to be able to walk away from that photo and come back and be like, well, I know that's the area I did it in, but I can't find where I did it. So I tend to use what I call a little bit harder tool that's going to make me do a little bit more work. Because I don't want that to show up on a printed photo. And trust me, it will at some point. Those couple of shades might not look like much on a monitor, but it's a lot when you're printing a photo. So for the most part, if you need to fix something like that, the Content Aware is great. I would suggest that be the first tool you run to try to fix it. But really take a good look at it. If you're seeing anything that you just don't like, try one of the other tools. But now we're going to go in and we're going to do the sharpening and noise reduction, and the basic noise reduction, not the fun little noise reduction that has been added, because we honestly don't have time to do that. So we're going to bring up, and this picture is this picture does have noise in it. But for the most part, it's not horrible. You see more of the noise in the eyes of the fox. When you sharpen, you add noise. When you get rid of noise, you get softness. Eyes are the most important thing. So now, if you notice, I have noise in there. And for the most part, yeah, they're sharp, but I don't want that noise as much as it is. So you have to find balance. So pretty much I'm going to play with my luminance. And you'll have to excuse. Apparently, here we go. So, all right. So the first thing we're going to do, I want to show you, is this. On your sharpening, on Windows, if you click Alt and you go to masking and you slide it and you see the white disappearing, where the white is, that's what's being sharpened right now. Okay, so gonna go about there, or maybe it's not. But it gives you a mask to see what you're doing to your image. When you're sharpening, you really don't want to go more than 50%. They tell you at that point, when you're going beyond 50%, you're adding noise. So then when you go to take the noise away, what are you doing? All that sharpening you just did, you're removing it, because now you're trying to get rid of the little tiny pixels that you've increased. So the bottom line is, on sharpening, never really more than 50%. Sometimes I'll do a little bit more, but it's at a cost. Everything you do is going to be at a cost. If you notice, I'm removing noise from this image, but what's happening to his eyes? They're going soft. I can increase the detail. It helps a little bit, but not by much. So I'm going to find that balance and say, okay, that's kind of where I like it. I might even bring the sharpening down a little bit more. You know, from far away, his eyes look sharp to me. Would I print this picture? No, it's not one of my pictures that I would ever print. But if I want to throw it up on a computer screen, I can, as a background. I'd be satisfied with it. His eyes are sharp. It's going to do what I want it to do. Excuse me?
Oh, where you got that was under
detail. That was under detail. So we'll go, in fact, we'll go down those right now real quick, just so that everybody knows. So under your basic tab, pretty much are all your basic editing, your basic color correcting. And this is what I'm going to go over really, really quick. Blue gets rid of yellow. Yellow counteracts blue. Green counteracts magenta red. Magenta red counteracts green. If it's opposite on the color wheel, it's going to counteract its opposite point. All right. Lightroom, it's always been cyan, yellow, magenta, and green. So we always worked with in editing. Add one, it affects the other. But sometimes you have to turn around and combine them all to make things right. And I honestly don't know how to explain that, because I think it's so ingrained in me from doing it. And I'm so used to doing it that I can't explain it. But sometimes you have to add blue or cyan when you're working with magenta, because there's a cast. And those are all things that as you're doing things and as you edit more and your eyes become aware of things, you'll notice. It's not something that you can explain or teach, but it's there. They work in conjunction. So again, under basic, you're gonna have your exposure, your contrast, your highlights, your shadows, your whites and your blacks. If you notice though, everything is paired. Everything is paired to go together. So you have one spectrum, then the other spectrum. And by playing with them both, you're gonna affect them both. Texture, clarity, and dehaze. Again, that's just, it affects sharpening, it affects softness, it affects how an image is perceived in the effect of, if you're outside and we see haze in the sky, so that's how I think of dehaze, is if you go outside on a warm summer night and you see that film in the sky, dehaze is going to remove that if you take a picture. Or you can add it in if it's not there. Your vibrance and your saturation, again, it's just, your saturation is how strong that color is, but your vibrance is how it appears. So you're not increasing the color of the red, you're increasing how you're perceiving it. We're not going to get into tone curve. That's, and the next three, primarily because, again, these guys, they all work in conjunction. Your tone curve works on your lights, your darks, your shadows, your highlights, your whites, your blacks. Again, that's a whole different thing, but you can see if you play with the line, how it affects the image, depending on where you play with that line, how it affects the image. Okay, it all does different things. All right, so your highlights, you can bring this up, your shadows, your darks, your blacks. You can also turn around and go into colors with it. There's different ways of doing things. You can affect your reds, your greens, your blues, your yellows. It's a matter of playing. Some people use this when they're split toning. There's other ways of doing it. You use saturation, luminance, and your color are under here. You can again affect different things by sliding things. Saturation, I can affect the saturation of my reds and remove them. The yellows, I can remove the saturation. You can break it down by color. Again, it's a real fun little place to go into and see what everything does. The luminance, here you go. You know, you play with the color. It's everything changes everything else. Then you can go into all, you have all of them just pretty much right there instead of having to click on each thing.
If you're shooting out in the sun, you've never noticed how your grass is getting really yellow and so forth. And using that, you can lower the yellow and increase the black.
Absolutely.
You can bring back the natural grass color and it doesn't look like it. Like you're shooting
it. Yes. Okay, so what Greg was just saying is when you're in your HSL and your color is by sitting there and playing with each individual color, you can turn around and bring something back or you can get rid of something. And it's right. So you might want an overall effect of color on an image, but you might need to bring some of the red back, but you can't do it. It's like fine tuning something. So, you know, you can have a string instrument and you can do a general tune, but then you need, you know, the A string a little bit better than the other strings because you're playing a chord with the A. So that's maybe a better way of thinking of the HSL in color. Is a fine tuning adjustments so that you can bring certain things out or remove certain things. So the next one is color grading. And with this, I really think a lot of it is just cut, just like the HSL and the color, but now you're looking at your highlights, your shadows, and your midtones, and you have kind of a color wheel to play with. I like the other one a little bit better because the color wheel can be a real pain. But you can see the different things you can do with it. If you click in the middle, it brings it right back. You can also then break down. You know, everything is separated. You can do just your luminance, you know, just your shadows, whatever you want to do. So I think they've repeated a couple different things. And I think part of it is maybe people are more comfortable using certain things. Some people might be more comfortable using the wheel. Some people might be more comfortable using the slider. Your detail is pretty much your noise and your sharpness. Again, with this, you could set, you could create a preset that says, okay, on every picture I import, I want 50% sharpening, which years ago, Lightroom used to turn around and tell you 50% sharpening because they'll tell you every image needs to be that little bit of sharpening. I've always imported with it. Do I see much of a difference? Because I have my new Lightroom on my main computer set up a little bit different. I haven't used it. I don't notice a difference. So, but like I said, everything, you can turn around and create a preset. I'm sure you can create a preset to denoise something. Lens correction, just pretty much exactly what it says. You are turning around and correcting any aberration from the lens. You know, each lens has its own little thing. You'll see if you're shooting wide angle, you will definitely notice when you turn around and do your lens correction, it's going to try to fix things that go in or out. It's going to try to do some of the things that you're still going to wind up doing and just make the job easier. You can also manually turn around and go in and do a lens correction. I've never had to. Thankfully, all my lenses that I use are profiled. I think I've only had one lens that wasn't profiled. And it was kind of fun to try to find a profile for it. And trust me, I didn't find one. So it didn't matter because it wasn't so horrible or wonky that I couldn't work with what it was and to go into the normal things to fix it. But if you notice, here you go. They even have for your iPhones, you can lens correct for them. There's profiles. So your transform, I do, when I use transform, it's kind of turning around. You can set it up to do auto. So we're going to go back to this image real quick. And I'm going to click auto. Now, it just went and fixed the photo at how it thought it should be. And to make it so that we can really see it, let's go to reset. So there's the reset. I clicked auto. So now, here you go. It fixed the image. But if you notice, now I have all these blank edges. So before I do anything, I'm gonna turn it off. I want it to constrain the crop, which it should not, when I click auto now, give you those funny edges. So it's telling you, you want it to kind of stay the way it is. You don't want it to crop it really weird, but you want it to fix the lines. And it did. And for the most part, it did a pretty good job. Sometimes with buildings, I tend to notice it does a good job, but I tend to see that I want to use the offsets a little bit. It gets you partway there, but you still need to turn around and do some work. At least for me, maybe I'm just super picky about it and it drives me nuts when I'm seeing something that just feels weird, like almost like the building's tilting towards me. So don't be afraid to use them. And it's not going to really work on this picture but you could see by playing, you know, a little bit what you can do. And sometimes it's personal. How you want it to look is personal preference. But like I said, that is good. But when you're using it, always hit that constrained crop because it helps. If you don't hit constrained crop and you hit the auto or you offset your image and you do all the things that you have to do to it, sometimes you can't crop it the way you want because of how it cut the image apart to fix it. By hitting constrained crop, you don't have to worry about that. Now you have something workable to do. And if you notice, you can go, like, it'll give you guided. Like I told it, I wanted it leveled. Here I want the vertical corrected. You know, here I'm saying I want the whole thing corrected. So it has a lot of different things. And like I said, it's something you kind of have to play with because each image is going to be different. Your effects, vignette, as I said before, not every image needs it. Some images do, but it has to be done right. If you want something subtle, you know, unless you're going really artistic. But going to the left makes it dark. Going to the right makes it white. So there you go. When I look at something like this, I think of like those like 1950s photos, images that your mom had when she had her picture taken, you know, by the photographer and they had the family portrait done. But again, grain, honestly, I do not use it. I don't even use it for black and white. I don't like it. If I wanted noise in my image, well, then I guess I would have taken the noise out of my image if it was there. It has a purpose for some people, has a purpose somewhere, or else it wouldn't be in here, but I don't have a purpose for it. So I don't play with it. Maybe you want to play with it to see what it can do for an image, but it's not my style, so I've never really gone that route. Presets, there's thousands and thousands of them out there, free. There are thousands and thousands of them out there that you can pay for. I will send a list out of ones that I have paid for, and I love them. And I'll send a list out as, you know, pointing in direction for some of the free ones as well. I probably have well over 1,000 presets on my working computer for my editing. But the fact of the matter is, again, a preset is not set it and forget it. It's not going to do your work for you. It's a jumping point. Sometimes it's a really cool jumping point, and it brings out stuff. And sometimes you're just like, what did I just do? And then that's where the history button comes in, takes it back, or just reset and start over again. Lightroom has a lot of stuff. And to start off, this is really, you know, the basics. And it can do a lot. It can supposedly do panoramas now, but I haven't really used it for that. But like I said, there's a lot of things that can be done with it. The final thing we're going to go over is just a real quick export of exporting an image. So you're done with this image. You're ready to export it to go out. You would be exporting it out to wherever you want to save your images. Now, when I export, nothing stays on my computer. Nothing. I have, you know, a master archive. I have yearly archives. I probably have archives that are archived. But I try to turn around again. I'm the first one to admit my organization is out the window. So I have literally a big master archive and then two other master archives that sit on my desk that ADD does not work well with organizing. I can figure it out and I know where to find things. That's all that matters. If I die, they're never finding my pictures again. That's all there is to it. So primarily you want to go to File, Export. So now when you're in Export, you have to figure out where you want to export. And I'm just going to export to my desktop because this isn't my main computer. I'm not going to put it in a subfolder. Actually, I will. Just so that I know where to delete it later. Your file renaming, you can rename it. You can do whatever you want. When I save things and I turn around, and again, I'm probably like all over the board with this when I do stuff, and I'm trying to focus in. I do a custom name because if I'm scrolling through 1,000 photos, I might want to remember what it was without having to turn around and be like, well, what is that? With just a number. But I make sure I choose original file number. Not that it matters, because the card that it came off of has long been shot on 1,000 times already. But again, I keep the original file number and I do a custom name. So then you put in your custom text. and spell it right, because I've done that too. Then you can do a start number, but I'm not doing a start number, because that would be, say I was exporting 10 images that I'm naming Rodeo, the original file number, so they're all a different number, but I want it to start at 1. Then it'll start at 1. With this here, you don't have to worry about it when you're saving the original file number, because it's already different file names. Watermarking, very easy. You create your watermark, you put it in. I don't really mess with sharpening for screen. Your image sizing, if you're saving it for Facebook, 20 by 48 long edge. Okay, so that's what I would put in here. Go to long edge, 20 by 48. If I'm saving it for Facebook, screens are 72 DPI, pixels per inch, whatever you want to refer to it as. I save it at 100. Just in case, it's not going to change anything. 2048 for Facebook. All right. Sharpen. I don't sharpen for screen. I don't sharpen for anything. I don't worry about output sharpening. Your metadata, I put it all in there because on my computer, I have all my information in there. My telephone number, my copyright information. It's all there. Guess what? If you put it on Facebook, by the time it's uploaded, your metadata is stripped and out the door. But just leave it on so that you don't forget to put it on when you're uploading other things elsewhere. All right. Watermarking. I watermark absolutely everything. And it's real simple. Your copyright symbol. I used to do the year. I don't do the year anymore. Rose Scudieri Photography. Bang. It's copyrighted. Because I was making watermarks every year. Make a simple one. And you have to make a couple. I make a solid black, a solid white, and then I do a gray. Because not everything's going to show up, depending. All right. Your post-processing, you can turn around if I wanted to. Again, this is not my main editing computer, but I could turn around and export this and then have it pop open in Photoshop or into another program if I want to do something else to it. Not doing anything else to it. So I would just, at this point, click export. It's going to export it and it's going to pop it onto my main screen. So there, I have my folder untitled export. And there's my image. Okay. And you're going to turn around and you're going to export as a JPEG. So this is the image I was talking about before, real quick, where I had said that I run everything through Topaz and, you know, do a minor bit of sharpening and a minor bit of denoise on it. So that is where we're at. And I do have one other thing. And I, like I said, I will send this out in an email to you guys. There's a couple people I follow on YouTube, but Mark Denny, I really, really like his stuff. He does very, very short little videos on tips and tricks, some of the new things that came out in Lightroom. He goes over them. The biggest thing, Does he have ad? Yeah, he does a thing for Square because Square sponsors him. You know what? It's worth sitting through his like little 2-minute talk about Square to get the information that he's giving you. He's really good. I really like him. And there's a couple others. So I will put that all into an email and send it out to everybody. And for those, I guess I'll send to NIMAC that they can turn around and send it out to those who attended from other clubs tonight as well. So, and I know, Matt, you have to start wrapping up. It's 9:45. Thank you.
I want to thank Rose for her presentation. I don't see any questions in the chat anymore. I think Barbara had a question, but you just answered that. Basically, when you're done editing your image, you have to export it. That's the final process.
Actually, if anybody does have any questions, I will send my email out, and they're free to send me an email on asking a question, and I will try to walk them through whatever they need to be walked through.
Yeah, I put your email in the chat.
Okay,
It's there. So anybody wants to ask you questions, they can ask you
questions.
Yeah. Anybody has any questions that they thought of later or now, you can email them to Rose and she will answer them for you. Unfortunately, we have to clean up here at the library because we have to be out of here in 15 minutes. So this concludes our meeting. I will leave the meeting open for anybody else that wants to stay in it, but thank you very much, Rose.
Thank you.